Go. Here we go. Good morning. Good morning. Wow, good to see you all here this morning. Absolutely gorgeous Sunday morning. Got an extra hour of sleep, probably. Maybe some of you guys got here an hour early and then went out to breakfast. Yeah. It's good to see that we have our choir back. Hey. They did like 14,000 miles in 7 weeks across the United States and back. Wow. Yeah. So those kids got to learn. They know more about America than I do. That's cool. And you went to see Noah's Ark too. That's really cool. I got a call from Bob, from the Bob and Julie show. And Walsh, and he said he's in Nebraska. They are in Nebraska, and they're heading back this way. Be home in like 3 days. But I think they went and saw the Ark too. Yeah. So they're just out there on a road trip. Yeah. So I guess today's National Jesus Appreciation Sunday. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah. So, it's good to be here this morning. Got a few announcements. And let's see. Prayer requests. Remember, you can visit our website. Check out what's going on our website. You have prayer request forms you can fill out back there. Put them in the Agape box, offering box. Call or text us anytime. And we'll be praying for you and then praying with you and then we can get that passed on as well. And then we want to thank you again, as always, for your amazing generosity in giving. And God loves a cheerful giver. And obviously, there's a lot of cheerful givers that go to church here. And so I know we really appreciate that. And then website, you can visit the website, and there's links to YouTube, Facebook. You can also check out archive messages. And then you can go over the normal announcements. They're all up there about the women meet and in their time and the men's time of their Bible studies. You can check all that out. Franklin Graham, he's calling for an evening of prayer live on Facebook. Pray with me, he says, for an evening before the election. It's 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's tomorrow, Monday, November 2nd, with Franklin Graham. So prayer, national prayer. And then you can join him with that too. So that would be great. And then a prayer request. It's awesome to see Jeff Stokes here this morning. Praise God. Wow. I mean, I saw a picture of him, like they just glanced on their phone. I thought, wow, you know, he's bleeding pretty bad. And then at lunch, they showed us a picture of the close-up of the staples. Like 13 staples? Big staples holding his head together. It's like, man. So apparently he had a side lobotomy. Wow. That's pretty bad when you get hit your head on the roll bar or something, and that's like getting hit in the head with a baseball bat and busting your head open. Oh, there's kids here. Sorry. First time since May 31st. But hey, good to see you. Amazing. Don't ever talk back to her again. Man. Then I got a call or a text from Isaac Reiswig's daughter. And he's still down at Cedar Sinai, but he was outside of the hospital. He would just go in for chemotherapy. And so he had his first chemotherapy. And I'd heard from from Tony that he was doing pretty well. Things were going well. Because we'd heard, you know, the week before that he didn't have that infection. Well, then Lynette told me that the doctor told him, if you get a fever, you call immediately. So he got a fever and they took him, he's got an infection. So he's back in the hospital as of yesterday. So we'll need to continue to pray for him. Patsy's down there with him. But we don't want to hear that. But we know God's bigger than that. So we continue to pray for him. And then Kathy Anderson Myers, former sister-in-law. So it's not Kathy Anderson Myers. She's good. She's right here. It's her former sister-in-law. And she's had to go back into the hospital because she's got COVID pretty bad. Okay. Okay. Well, I'm glad God has that sorted out. So we'll pray for them. And they're down in San Luis Obispo. Okay. So we'll pray for them, the whole family. Then I got a call from Linda Hulsey. First time I texted Linda Hulsey, I sent her a text. I said, hey, call me when you can. And she texted me back and said, I'm in too much pain. And she had she fell down in her kitchen and broke her hip. And then she had a partial hip replacement. And so she called me yesterday. She sounded good, but she's in a rehab place, and so they're, as soon as she can walk on her own and get up on her own, then she'll be able to go home, but right now she can't stand, she can stand up, but not on her own, so we continue to pray for her. Tom Kerr, we're praying for him. He's probably ready to get back out on his motorcycle, and we'll continue to pray for him anyway. And then Chuck Bardot's cousin, Jamie Rose, Chris Como, Nancy Berger, Sarah Fink, Dave McGurr. And I'm telling you, this week was a bad week. It was, you know, it was what, Monday? Was it Monday night? So we hear that Cooper, Langstrom, Landrum. I know Freddie Langston, Landrum. He got killed on the off-ramp going to Ophir, you know, taking the 193. He was westbound 80 and taking 193 toward Lincoln and somehow lost control. They don't know. 22 years old. And he's, you know, we just know a lot of his extended family. And they live right across the street from Larry and Karen. And so we need to pray for his mom's Becca and his dad's Terry, and we'll pray for them. He was just a really nice young man, and it's just devastating. And then a 48-year-old guy from Grass Valley went to NU, so he graduated in, I think, 90, 91. His family, they're a big family name, and he lived off of Old Auburn. Anyway, 48 years old, he had a stroke and some kind of complications in a stroke. And so they called me to do the memorial service. He passed away. And he was really good friends of Pastor Sam Floyd. And so they called me because they knew I was a friend of Pastor Sam Floyd. So that was kind of an honor to kind of stand in because Sam Floyd already went to heaven. And so I got to preach the gospel to a lot of people, at least 30, at a graveside. And I'm telling you, you know, and I'm just, when I start talking about what Paul the Apostle says about where we go after we leave these tents, I mean, every time I get tickled because it sounds like I'm making it up, you know, like I'm paraphrasing what the Bible says about tents and stuff. And people always ask me, it really says in the Bible that we live in tents? Yeah, I didn't make that up. That's in the Bible. You know, and then we move into mansions. And then he says, we put on our heavenly mansion. We put it on. So, you know, we don't, you know, like we grew up in Sunday school, you walk the streets of gold and then you go up and you knock on the door of your buddy's mansion and say, hey, let's go do something. It's not like that. You sport your mansion, you know, so you're ready to go at any time and you can think and be there. Like Jesus already set precedent, right? So when I'm telling that and people are out there on the edge of their seat, it's just, I mean, I like weddings, but not as much as I like preaching the gospel at a believer's memorial service. It's just incredible. It's just incredible how the Holy Spirit, you can just tell they're captive because people are thinking, where am I going and who am I going with? That's what they're thinking about. And anyway, it was a good memorial service. And then I get a call of about a young man. He's 16. He took his own life right off of, right there by Alta Sierra. And I didn't recognize his last name, but I recognized his mom's last name. And so it's straight up the enemy. It was straight up spiritual warfare. And the enemy wants to destroy that Christian family. And the enemy's not going to destroy that Christian family. I mean, the enemy devastated that Christian family. So anyway, we'll pray for them. I was, you know, blown away when I went over to make contact with their extended family, and we know their extended family. You know, Marty, you know, we know her as Marty Caldwell, but she's Marty Christensen, and she owns the Grass Valley Event Center, and then she has that adoption agency. Well, it was her sister's son, and her sister is Sandy, and she runs WOW, Women of Worth. And so it was her 16-year-old son. And so I'm going to spend some time with the family this afternoon, right after church. And so be praying for that family as well. Like I said, they're not going to, it's straight up spiritual warfare. And then I heard that another person committed suicide yesterday too, but I haven't heard who that is, but it was in Grass Valley as well. So it's devastating. And so we'll pray for that as well. And then we want to pray for our first responders. There's Hank. He's in the Navy, but that's Hank. And we'll pray for him. Yeah, it's always an honor to pray for these young men and women. And our first responders. And a lot of our first responders are former military as well. Do you have a question or an answer?
Neither.
Neither.
Can you update us on your partner in crime?
Oh, yeah, Ron Smith. That was another crazy thing. So he ended up getting like 5, whatever you call those, blood transfusion, the units, 5 units of blood. I told him some of that blood must have been from a girl or something, because he's like found his feminine side, and but he sounds great on the phone. He's doing really well and he's home. So thank you for your prayers. He said, oh, yeah, thanks. Thanks for your prayers. That was too close. They said, yeah, if you wouldn't have come in, you'd be in heaven too. And I told him, hey, you know what? It's okay that you're going to heaven. But you don't have to go when you're 68 years old when you have an option, you know. So it was good he made it to the hospital and got that taken care of. But yeah, thanks. But we'll continue to pray for him as well. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you're an amazing God, and we're thankful that we can come and worship you. We love you. You blow our minds, and so we just pray that you would continue to blow our minds and heal those that are sick among us. Lord, we just pray that you just reach inside of them and you do what you do best. You make things new. So we pray that you would reach inside of them and make things new. Lord, we pray that you would draw them closer to you than they've ever been before, that you'd wrap your arms around them, that they would know your presence. And so, Lord, we lift up our first responders and those that serve our country, and we just thank you for them and just pray that you would protect them. Lord, that you would pour out your grace upon them, Lord. Lord, we just pray that you'd bless them and bless their families as well. Lord, we think about our country and the election coming up, and Lord, we just pray that your will be done. And Lord, no matter how it comes out, Lord, we know the sky's not falling because you're in control. And so, Lord, we lift that up to you. We lift up the election. We lift up our country. Lord, as rumors of war, and we just pray that you would just show how in control that you are. And Lord, so we lift up our president. We pray that you would protect him. We pray that you would give him wisdom. Lord, we pray that there would be continued, that you would stack in Christians around him, Lord, that would give him wise counsel. Lord, we also pray for humility across the board. And so, Lord, we're thankful again that we can come here and spend this time worshiping you. So we pray that with all the craziness going on, that you would help us eliminate those outside distractions. Lord, I think about the people just this week and the last couple weeks that have lost family members, and some of them in just horrific ways. Lord, we just pray that you would comfort them, that your word says you're the God of comfort. And so we just pray that you would comfort them. You're the God of all peace. We pray for that peace that passes understanding. We pray that you would wrap your arms around them, and they too would know your presence, Lord. Lord, that they are devastated, but Lord, they're not destroyed because the battle belongs to you. And so we lift them up to you as well. And this morning, Lord, we're going to focus on who we are in Christ. And so, Lord, we just pray that as we lift up our voices to you in praise and worship, Lord, that you would be blessed. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's worship.
yesterday. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God. tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Let the river flow. Let
you, Lord. That'd be our prayer, to walk humbly with you, God. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would teach us this morning. You'd open your word to us, to our hearts. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can turn your Bibles. You have your Bibles. You can turn to Psalm 149. We're continuing our trek through the Psalms. And, you know, it's interesting how we've just been going through the Psalms just in random order. In the last couple weeks, we've been going through Psalms in order. But it wasn't by design. It's just how it ended up. You know, when I'm going through that book with that Bob Blakesmith wrote, I'm praying the Psalms, and so we end up today with sing to the Lord a new song in Psalm 149. And one of the things that we're going to get out of this is that God is God, okay, and He's in control, and the battle belongs to Him. The battle straight up belongs to Him. So you know, in regards to things in our life, probably especially in regards to things. You know, that election day, it's you know, when I'm going through this, it's like, okay, doesn't matter. Bottom line, the sky is not falling, okay? Because God's in control. And so the psalmist that they're going through this, it's, if you look at Psalm 149, this is another of the last five psalms that have no title in the Hebrew text, but each of the last five begin and end with hallelujah, which is one word for praise the Lord, okay? And all these psalms at the end, that's what they begin and end with. Matthew Henry, he says this. He says, the foregoing psalm, with the one we saw last week, was a hymn of praise to the Creator, and this is a hymn to the Redeemer. Now, as we go through this, I've been cleaning out books. I've been going through and cleaning out thinning the herd, so to speak, of commentaries, okay? And so I had commentaries lined up of Stott and Ironside and G. Campbell Morgan and Spurgeon, and I mean, the list goes on, and I found them in Psalms. And so I was reading through them in the last two Sundays and this Sunday, and I go right back to G. Campbell Morgan, because a lot of these other guys, they must have read G. Campbell Morgan, okay? And then Spurgeon. There are some things in here that I'm going to read you today. I don't know if they're going to blow your mind, but they blew my mind. But I'm going to read this first. Is Psalm 149. Follow along with me. We'll read it first, and then we'll break it up a little bit. The psalmist says, praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, His praise in the assembly of the godly. Let Israel be glad in his Maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their King. Let them praise His name with dancing, making melody to Him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in His people. He adorns and the humble with salvation. Let the godly exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their throats and two-edged swords in their hands, to execute vengeance on the nations and punishments on the peoples, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute on them the judgment written. This is the honor for all His godly ones. Praise the Lord. This is what Bob Blakesmith wrote in his book, Praying the Psalms, A G-Man's Journey Down the Psalter Trail. He says, do you have a favorite hymn of old? One that you can recall and sing every stanza from memory? There are many from which to select, most based on scripture and classically timeless. But every once in a while, we hear something fresh that comes along and to become our latest favorite. This is one of the six psalms which talks about singing a new song to the Lord. We serve a God who is a creator of all and loves to make things anew. He proclaims new things to us, hidden things previously unknown. He will one day make all things new, including a new heaven and a new earth. Once we come to Christ, He makes us into a new person, a new creation, where our old self passes away and we are transformed. This new life instills in us a new song. Let the word of Christ richly indwell us so we can sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs anew to our God with thankfulness in our hearts. Well, you know, Psalm 149, this is a psalm, when you read it, you don't realize it, but this is a psalm that about the end times. This is a prophetic psalm. This is, you know, eschatology, the end times. So I guess if you live in Eschaton Village, you're probably in your end times, okay? So that's what this is. It celebrates a victory here. It's a victory of the Lord. So our God won victories for us in our past. He's winning victories for us right now in our present, and he's going to win victories for us in our future. And so praise the Lord for what he's doing now. And Psalm 149 in our text this morning, verses 1 through 4, praise the Lord for what he is doing now. Verse 1, praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song. So this praise is given voice, okay? We're going to praise God, but it's given a voice here because we're singing to the Lord a new song. And it's a new song. It's a song of salvation. It's a song of celebration and hope. See, we see Psalm 149 as fruit from a seed planted from our psalm last week in Psalm 148:14, where it says, he has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his saints, for the people of Israel who are near him, praise the Lord. And we noted last week, if you remember, we noted last week that speaks of the power of salvation. When he raises up a horn, that was a symbol of power. And so this speaks of the power of salvation, the salvation of the Lord on the behalf of his people. It says, for all the saints. And then back in our text in verse 1b, it says, his praise in the assembly of the godly. So our God loves us. He loves us, and we love him in return. And so his love has been made known time and time and time after time and time again. It's been made known to us. We've seen it through his mighty acts of salvation. We've seen it. We've read about it. We've experienced it. We've seen it in other people. And so the nature and character of our God is then communicated in three particular ways, and those expressions help us understand all the more why we sing a new song of salvation, and all the more why we delight in our Lord. Verses 2 through 4, he says, let Israel be glad in his maker, and let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. So praise the Lord in song because he is our creator. He is our maker. And the focus is on the nation of Israel right here. That's where the psalmist is focusing here. He's focusing on the nation of Israel, and he's not focusing on the material things or you know, the things that God created like we saw last week, you know, in Genesis 1 and 2. See, the Lord brought Israel into existence and established her as a nation and established the Israelites as his people, and it was completely by his doing. God did that. It had nothing to do with them. It wasn't their doing. It was an act of grace, and that is the cause of celebration. That's why they're celebrating. That's like, you got to be kidding me. I think about, when I go over verses like this, I think about Habakkuk. You know, when all the things that he went through, and he lost everything. He lost his family, lost his crops, lost everything. Now they're going to come and kill him. And he reflects on that. And he says, though I've lost everything, I can jump for joy and spin in circles because God is the God of my salvation. That's paraphrase, but that's what he says, right? And so this celebration, because that makes their hearts glad. That makes our hearts glad. In verse 3, let them praise his name with dancing. So praise the Lord with dancing because he is our king. They just can't help it. Okay, the focus of their worship is clear and select because it's their maker. It's their king. And the expression of their worship in song is accompanied by a melody to him with a tambourine and a lyre. C.H. Spurgeon says this, and I'm going to read you several of these quotes because You'll see. This is out of the Treasury of David in the Psalms, C.H. Spurgeon. He says, "Let them repeat the triumph of the Red Sea, which was ever the typical glory of Israel." Okay, God saves them again, right? In this case, Miriam led the daughters of Israel in the dance when the Lord had triumphed gloriously. Was it not most fit that she should? The sacred dance of devout joy is no example, nor even excuse for frivolous dances, much less for lewd ones. Who could help dancing when Egypt was vanquished and the tribes were free? Every mode of expressing delight was bound to be employed on so memorable an occasion. Dancing, singing, and playing on instruments were all called into requisition, and most fitly so. There are unusual seasons which call for unusual expressions of joy. When the Lord saves a soul, its holy joy overflows, and it cannot find channels enough for its exceeding gratitude. If the man does not leap or play or sing, at any rate he praises God, and he wishes for 1,000 tongues with which to magnify his Savior. Who could wish it to be otherwise? Young converts are not to be restrained in their joy. Let them sing and dance while they can. How can they mourn now that their bridegroom is with them? Let us give up the utmost liberty to joy. Let us never attempt its suppression, but issue in the terms of this verse a double license for exaltation. That's brilliant. That right there makes you want to, you know, it's like, yes, yes. He's talking about that verse. Let them praise his name with dancing because he is their king, because he is their maker. See, the people of God truly experience showers of blessing from the Lord. The Lord pours out his blessing upon them. And the psalmist tells us in verse 4 back in our text, he says, "For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation." The word "adorns" here has meaning to glorify or beautify. So he glorifies or beautifies the humble with salvation. Isaiah, you know, we usually read this, Isaiah 55, and we usually start in verse 8. But listen to this. In verse 6, he says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way. Let the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." And then he goes on, and you think about that, about our own selves, about abundantly being pardoned and forsaking our wicked ways, right? And turning, repenting and turning and following God. And then he says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." You know, those who trust in the Lord receive his salvation. They receive his victory. And those who humble themselves before King Jesus in faith and repentance are blessed in victory over sin. We're blessed in victory over sin. We're blessed in victory over sin, over Satan, over death, over hell. It's amazing. And in 1 John 4:19, we love because he first loved us. And it's amazing that God would take pleasure in saving rebellious sinners. You know, you think about it, it's like God takes blessing in saving rebellious sinners who are his enemies. You know, and that's direct evidence of his grace. That's direct evidence of his kindness. You know, praise the Lord for what he will do in the future. And again, these last five verses point to the future. They point to end times, and they point to specific details of the Lord's final victory. Follow along in verses 5 through 9 back in our text. He says, "Let the godly exult in glory. Let them sing for joy in their beds." You know, most of the commentaries I read about that said they They really don't know exactly what that means, you know. But the Lord will give his people peace, obviously, when they celebrate. They sing for joy on their beds in God's final victory to the Prince of Peace, because he will reign. And you think about it, well, I guess that would be very, well, you know that you have peace if you can just stay in bed and sing. I guess that's that peace maybe that passes understanding. But this is what Isaiah says in verses 6 through 7 of chapter 9. He says, and this is another one, you know, usually we read this at Christmas. But when it says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. He's in control. He is in control. And then back in our text, verse 6, he says, let the high praises of God be in their throats and the two-edged swords in their hands. And G. Campbell Morgan. Their praise is not merely to be that of the chanting of words. It is also to be in the doing of his will. While the high praises of God are in their mouth, a two-edged sword is to be in their hand, with which they carry out his purposes among the peoples, the kings, and the nobles. And so Spurgeon says this. He says, the word of God is all edge. I love this. It's all edge. Whichever way we turn it, it strikes deadly blows at falsehood and wickedness. If we do not praise, we shall grow sad in our conflict. Think about that, because we're in the middle of a conflict. And if we don't praise, we're going to grow sad in our conflict. I've grown sad in that conflict, right? So he says, if we do not praise, we shall grow sad in our conflict. And if we do not fight, we shall become presumptuous in our song. He said the verse indicates a happy blending of the chorister and the crusader. So verse 7, it says in our text, to execute vengeance on the nations and punishments of the peoples. Well, Spurgeon says this, if you had a sword of steel, you would fight with men. But that is no part of your business. You are not called to that cruel work. But as you have the sword of the Spirit, go forth and praise God by the use of that two-edged sword, which is the word of God. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Wow. As a result, the ultimate judgment of the world, you know, are the subjects of this, of Psalm 149, the call to fight and the battle and the blessing, they're inseparable in the Christian life. So back in our text in verses 8 and 9, it says to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron. This is what Derek Kidner says. Our equivalent of binding kings with chains is to take every thought captive to obey Christ. Man, that's thinking before you speak, right? You take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. I was thinking about that. Could you imagine if you ever watched a debate where people actually took each thought captive to the obedience of Christ? And so what he's talking about here is how you fight the battle. It's not where this is taken out of context and you think, okay, we're just going to kill them all and let God sort them out. Even though we might feel that way. No, that's not what he's talking about here. That's beautiful how he says that. He says our equivalent of binding kings with chains is to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. 2 Corinthians 10:5. And then in verse 9, back in our text, to execute on them judgment written. This is is honor for all his godly ones. Praise the Lord. Well, you can see how that put that, you know, how that comes together. G. Campbell Morgan says this: there is no reference in this psalm to the church of God. As it specifically indicates, it has to do with Israel, with the children of Zion. And so Spurgeon follows up with this. He said it would be a sad thing for anyone to misuse this text, lest any warlike believer should be led to do so. We should remind him that the execution must not go beyond the sentence and the warrant, and we have received no warrant of execution against our fellow men. Yeah, that's amazing. So the saints, the saints are resting peacefully on their beds, praising the Lord, because we know that that God's in control, that he's the shot caller. And then they're also exalting the Lord with the two-edged sword in their hands. And so the exaltation, the praise of God is in their mouths, has the future and final victory in their mind. When you're praising God and you have the Word of God in your hand, you have that view of the final victory. And yet, though they have swords in their hands, it must be the Lord who fulfills the judgment. It's not us. It's not us to judge, to fulfill that judgment of verses 7 and 9. So this is a prophetic hopefulness of Revelation 19, 11 through 16. John says, then I saw the heaven open. I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. And from his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of fury of the wrath of God, of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Right here, we're spectators. We're spectators in this. We're not participators in this judgment on the nations. It's Jesus, and it's Jesus alone. And our God is truly a God of salvation. And he saved the nations of Israel. We know it. We've seen it. We've read it time and time again throughout the Old Testament history. And today, he's saving individuals from every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. He saves them. And as history draws to a close, and it is drawing to a close, and the Antichrist and his evil empire appears to have won the battle, okay, because sometimes we think, oh my, our Lord's going to come again from heaven. He's going to destroy them with all the power of his word. With his word. And his people will share in his glorious victory. And what an honor that's going to be. What an honor, amazing honor that's going to be. And so all of this, there's only one appropriate word. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Because he is the victorious king. The battle does belong to him. You know, in Psalm 140, you know, to the choir master, a psalm of David, it gives us a clue as to why we would sing a new song. Verses 1 through 4. He says, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and he heard my cry. He drew me up from a pit of destruction out of the miry bog and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. After doing that, he put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. That's you just try to relate that to ourselves and the different situations that we go through in life. You know, C.H. Spurgeon says this: he is ever new in his manifestations. His mercies are new every morning. His deliverances are new in every night of sorrow. Let your gratitude and thanksgiving be new also. Amen. You know, and then forever God will continue it, like Ephesians 2:7. Forever God will continue so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. And as he does, for his glory and for our joy, we're going to keep singing a new song. And it's awesome. It's awesome to be just, and you know, driving down the road, laying in your bed. You're just like, thank you, God. When everything else is like Habakkuk, you know, when everything else looks like it's gone to hell, I can jump for joy and spin in circles because God is the God of my salvation. So I'll close this with, and then we'll have communion, but I'll close this with Bob Blacksmith's prayer. He says, "Oh God, let me join in the union with all your saints to sing unto you a new song of praise. Old things may pass away, but you make everything new. Let all your children dance and praise and make music unto you. For you love your people and have demonstrated it by providing us with the sustaining salvation. It is all the more reason for me to sincerely sing for joy. I can rest assured in your love and sing my song of praise at all times, whether simply slumbering in bed or standing strong to do your will. Let my hand hold fast to your sword of truth, your word, for by it your justice will prevail, putting in the proper place the princes of this world. For any judgment I render is not mine, but it is the honor you have given to those who are faithful to you. May I worthily walk in the way you desire. All praise be unto you, O Lord." Amen. Amen. You know, when you just thinking about that, it just in these, you know, the way things are going, and you know, and it's like there are no coincidences, right? It's all God's providence. You know, and I'm thinking about that where he's talking about your word, for by it your justice will prevail. By his word, justice will prevail. Putting in the proper place the princes of this world, because God's in control of that. And for any judgment I render is not mine, but it is the honor you have given to those who are faithful to you. And it really comes back to using God's word, that we speak God's word, that we take each thought captive as unto the Lord to use his word. Because a man convinced against his will, or any person convinced against their will, is of the same opinion still. Because we can't convince somebody of the truth when their mind's already made up. So it's going to take the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. And then he gives us the Word to be able to dissect into that and actually make a difference. A lasting difference. Wow. So we're going to have communion to celebrate our salvation. To celebrate what Christ did on the cross for us. And so you have these little communion things. Lori's going to do a little song so you can figure out how to open them. You know, that the first part layer has that little piece of styrofoam in there. And then you pull that other layer back. And so she'll let you figure that out and sing this song.
Crushed for our sins, the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds we are healed. He was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. Transgressions, crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds we are healed.
Thank you, Lord. Let's partake. Lord, just having that aftertaste in our mouth. Lord, just knowing that we've just shared communion together and that by your wounds we are healed and that we're saved and that we can sing praises to you. Because you're an amazing God and we thank you. We thank you that we have that victory in you. And so, Lord, we do pray. Especially this week. Lord, we know you're sovereign. We know that you're in control. And Lord, we look forward to this week to see how that works out. In the midst of that, Lord, we just pray that we would rest assured as believers, as followers, that no matter what happens, that you're in control. The sky is not falling. And Lord, that you reign. And so we pray that. We pray again for wisdom, for peace, and your will. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's close in song.
Peace that endureth. summer, winter, summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars with their courses above. Join with all nature in manifold witness to
Wow. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's awesome. All right. Well, God bless you guys. Have a great week. If you need anything this week, be sure to get a hold of us. There's a card in the back that Kim has for Isaac. If you want to stop and say God bless you and we love you and all that stuff.
Yeah, we're going to take just a second.
Oh, stop.
It is Pastor Appreciation Day for all the pastors here. Jeff, we want to present you with the
team. Oh, wow.
And we do appreciate you.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you. Wow. I got to tell you, I was hoping people forgot. And that is why I said that this is Jesus Appreciation Day. Yeah. You forgot. Thank you. Thank you. I'm glad. Anyway, well, thank you. Thank you very much. And I appreciate you as well. And so God bless you guys. Have a great week. And we'll see you next week. Again, if you need something, call out to us. And then help us stack chairs. And that's it. Wow.